putting prices on people's lives. You're saying that it doesn't work.
Pat brought up a point earlier.
This brings us back to the basic question, which I'd like to return to.
Oh, I disagree with Mr. President.
I know. Why don't you respond to that?
Well, I think the Brady bill is working. I mean, I think it's working here in New York City, for
instance. Four prosecutions in total for the first year.
Let's hear it.
ATF, in New York City, ATF has, and I'm going to talk about federal firearms licensing, because those are the people who receive guns with those licenses from manufacturers. They're distributors of weapons, and those are the people that that either are the, what we call the tabletop, the sort of the kitchen seller of guns, and they receive the mass amount of guns into this city, and these are the guns that get onto the streets and kill people.
Criminals receive these guns.
Well, from legitimate licensors, from FFL, those are federal firearms licensees who have these licenses, and under the Brady bill now, what happens in New York City is that ATF has to notify NYPD, and NYPD goes out and they do an investigation and a face-to-face interview with an individual who wants an FFL. And the reason this is so important is because they find out where they live. What we found in New York City, that a lot of FFL holders
lived in. Tell us an FFL again for the uninitiated. Okay.
And those are the people who are licensed to receive guns from manufacturers, numerous guns, as many as they care to purchase at a location.
Are there a lot of licensed criminals have a lot of gun licenses? There are a lot of people you arrest in Brooklyn violent crimes that turn out to be carrying licensed guns.
It's not that they have
you're in the business
that
they,
can you that they have
received,
that they are able
to
purchase
those weapons from
people who do have FFLs, because they don't keep records for the most part, and they allow those guns to filter their way onto the street. And that's what we're talking about here. And they've been restricted. They're down 96%.
I'm going to shift this. We've got a few points that we want to cover, so I'm going to try to move through some of these. Now, I'd like Mr. Price to respond to this, and I want to get Pat. You know, a California state court judge ruled that the maker of guns used to kill 8 people in California can be sued for the deaths. And I want to get your response to that and what you think about that particular legislation, and whether that legislation would spread and maybe come to states like New York, New Jersey,
okay,
Connecticut.
The judge did not say that they were liable, but merely that they could move forward on a liability lawsuit. Now, I think on appeal, and as this goes up the line, it's going to go down. And the reason it's going to go down, Mike, is because if you're going to attach liability to an inanimate object, such as a firearm, okay, then the next thing to do is take a look at Philadelphia, where the vast majority of homicides, they're having a problem with bats. So you're going to have to do something about bats. You're going to have to do something about knives. You're going to have to do something about cars and bicycles, and even the plastic that covers dry cleaning, because kids suffocate. These stats are a lot higher than the problem we're having. So unless you're prepared to legislate against the iron foundry that made it, UPS, the shipper, the Department of Highways.
They're attaching liability to a manufacturer that knows it's manufacturing guns.
But the point is that idiocy and that logic will not sustain. We believe that as this goes up the line, it's going to go down. Because otherwise, every single item will be liable.
He's comparing a bat and a bicycle with the instrument of human destruction.
And I don't think
you can do that. Sure. What happened in San Francisco was the courts allowed the people to go ahead with a civil suit against a gun maker. And the reason was because the Tech 9, the military-style assault weapon pistol that could fire 50 rounds in one clip and shot up 14 people, killing 8, served no legitimate purpose. And in fact, what that gun maker had done, and by legitimate purpose means sporting or self-defense purpose, and what happened is that manufacturer in Florida had altered that weapon so that it would meet the California assault ban standards, and therefore they could manufacture it. And this was their response: well, we can manufacture, distribute it, and sell it legally.
I think that's a very positive step.
And having these gun makers have some type of responsibility, be it civil or criminal liability, for their acts when they know that they are catering to an illicit market.
I think you're doing apples and oranges here. Now, Eric, I'll let you jump in. I just don't see people running out buying bats in record numbers to kill people with.
But in Philadelphia, that's a major crime problem. I mean, people are getting their brains beaten out with bats, okay? So I'm saying, by logical extension, let's not talk about everything from bicycles to iron foundries to UPS. Let's make them all liable. That seems to be the legal way.
Eric,
it makes no sense.
Yeah, Pat, you made an interesting point. You spoke about guns for self-defense purposes. Obviously, you then recognize that guns can be used by law-abiding citizens for self-defense purposes. If this is a part of your view of how the world works, why doesn't it make sense that we try to arm and train a population that's besieged by crime and without expecting policemen to become personal bodyguards for people, which is utterly unrealistic.
Well, you know, you can fight fire with fire, but I don't think you can fight anarchy with anarchy.
I'm not talking about anarchy.
And I think that's what you're talking about, because I do not think
that... I said an organized program. That's not anarchic at all.
She's trying to answer the question.
I think that Americans are besieged, certainly, by crime and the criminal issue, and I think that we need to address those issues, those social issues, that make crime rates go up and go down. And I think that our sort of...
What social issues?
Our romantic
What social issues make crime rates go up and down?
I'm talking about unemployment. I'm talking about poverty. I'm talking about people not being educated.
So society's fault.
We need to deal with
crime
those issues, as opposed
fault.
To thinking yes. that arming ourselves and shooting everybody is going to have any kind of positive result in our community.
And yet you have...
And people like Mr. Presser are organizations...
Experience.
That
Don't
give
you?
People $500 when they yeah. when they kill someone.
Okay, we can and get then, to that. We can get to that.
You know, why can't you take that $500
and put
it
this.
To a
positive?
Explain,
yeah, can you explain?
But you are familiar with the Los Angeles. You are experienced with the Los
yeah.
Angeles
explain,
experience,
explain the,
where the riots, the only thing that held back the riots to any degree, were certain the Koreans and storekeepers
who
that basically had armed themselves and defended themselves.
Absolutely.
Because the police weren't there.
Mr. Price,
the police, with all the respects to police enforcement, you don't have a constitutional mandate to protect. I mean, you can dial 911. If they get there, they get there. What do you do with the bodega owner who needs to protect himself when 911 doesn't respond?
How do you know that if you arm the population that the individuals out here holding the guns are going to be responsible? How do you know that?
Well, I know currently that those that have the guns are not responsible.
How do you know that everybody who holds the gun
because the bulk of the guns, Mike, are in the hands of the illegitimate. In New York State today, you have almost 1 million pistol licensees, and each one owns roughly 2 or 3 guns.
So you're saying
surely
make it
you know
easier,
that statistically,
you're saying make it easier for
we are
100%
law-abiding citizens that have given you no grief.
Are you saying
we
make,
are not the problem?
Are you
we
saying,
never were.
Are you saying make it easier for everyone to get guns?
Make it fairer. Okay, what's good for Donald Trump and a Sullivan ought to be good for you.
Well, no,
for
those viewers, make it easier, viewers, and that's
no,
not wrong.
Make
Pat,
it work fair. Whether it's a black store owner or a Hispanic store owner, make it easier.
I'm very troubled by Jerry Prysor rewarding people who actually kill in self-defense.
Well, for people, even, don't know, for people who don't know, for the viewers who don't know what Mr. Prysor does, let's explain what he does.
I'm about to ask.
All right. No, let's let Mr. Prysor explain what he does.
Our organization... 3 or 4 times a year, offers a $500 Courageous Citizen Award to an individual who, within legal parameters, defends himself and uses deadly force. And there have been several police officers that
have been
really rewarded also.
Is that really responsible?
We are encouraging the individual to fight back when 9/11 just doesn't work.
Pat, why do you object to that?
I think we used
you
to
You reward death, you don't reward self-defense.
Pat, why do you object
guidelines.
To that?
I object to it on any number. I think it's immoral. I think that... you know, first of all, I don't know how many people accept the money. You know, I'd be interested in finding out how many will accept the money for that.
Well, what's the basis of your objection?
My objection is that it's blood money. We give people money for killing a human being. That's outrageous.
For defending themselves.
That's an outrageous type of concept. Yeah, it's killing people. Whether it's defense, whether you're defending yourself or not, we are saying to you, oh, you dad a boy, you did a good job, you killed somebody. You know, and here's your money. You're talking about gunfighters, we're talking terrorists, we're talking vigilantes. You know, I mean, call them what soldiers of fortune, call them what you want to call them, but that's what those people become.
Do you consider yourself a vigilante, Mr. Prysor? Would
it surprise you to know that the hit ratio of the New York City Police Department in terms of shooting at felons is less than 3%? And that civilians actually do better than 20%. We actually do a bit, that may be because of the suicidal guidelines that are imposed on police officers, but civilians do rather well. What you're saying to the store owner is, lay down, take it, cooperate, give them the money, and with the hopheads and cocaine addicts out there, they're still going to blow this guy's brains out. Are you going to deal with that family?
Paying people for death.
Why can't that individual, Pat, defend himself? Why are you against that?
What kind of example does that send to our children that you pay for death? What does that say to our society? What kind of signal does it send to our
kids? We're saying that you have the right to defend yourself because the police, unfortunately, can't be everywhere.
Pat, Ms. Gatling, can I ask you a question about self-defense and living a dignified life? Don't we have a danger in this city if the vast majority of people are walking around scared and unable to defend themselves and knowing that their circumstances are such that it might well be wise for them to have money on them so that if they get held up by someone, they surrender their valuables? Haven't we paid a price in terms of personal dignity? to the crime, to the fact that violent crime overwhelms us?
I think that in New York City, one of the biggest problems is apathy. And I think that if more individuals became more involved with the criminal justice system, and I don't know, always mean in a negative sense, I mean reporting crime and dealing with issues, that they wouldn't feel as though they were always the victim. And I think that's just sort of a New York response to the crime. But our crime rate in New York is a lot lower than in most cities. In most cities.
It's going down.
And I think that people
have... I even meant nationally.
And I think people do have certainly a right to defend themselves if they are under physical violence. I'm not saying that they don't. I'm just saying, why is it that our solution here and the answer that Mr. Presser would give would be to arm ourselves instead of dealing with the violent issue? And I think the media has played a large part in that, and some of the responsibility lays at your feet
for this. I'm simply saying that those individuals who opt for a firearm for self-defense and they take their training and they pass muster and go through a 6-month or a year period, you ought to give them that license and not hold them back.
I'd like to ask, let me pose
that's
this question.
That's a reasonable approach.
Let me pose this question. We all have guns. Eric has a gun, I have a gun, Pat has a gun, you have a gun. What is to prevent fender benders from turning into Dodge City, from turning into gunfights on our streets?
But Mike, statistically, it just doesn't happen. As evidenced by the 1 million licensees in the state of New York, where the incidence of misuse is statistically negligible. And that comes right from the superintendent of state police. It just doesn't happen.
Well, you know, I don't even know where those statistics are coming from because
in New York,
but I don't think his statistics are accurate. I don't think the information he has is accurate because in New York State, if you have a license to carry a handgun and you shoot someone, you cannot be charged with a certain crime under 265 of the penal law. You can only be charged with violating a license, which is a 400 crime in the penal law, and it's a misdemeanor and not a felony.
Okay,
I haven't read your stats,
but Eric said earlier that stats can be used to bolster any argument.
Michael, but I'm quoting
I'm
the
sorry.
Superintendent
I'm sorry,
of State
I have
Police.
To, I have to tell you, we're really running low on time, and although a slightly technical note, it points up the vast differences that I think separate a lot of us on these issues. Nevertheless, it's possible to have a vigorous debate. And we wouldn't have had a vigorous debate if you hadn't been willing to join us. So thanks to you, Pat Gatling, Executive Assistant to Brooklyn DA Joe Hines, long experience in the criminal justice system in the state of New York. Thanks to you, Jerry Prizer, President of the New York State Rifle and Pistol Association.
Thank you.
Michael, we're down to the wire. Where did I convince you that I was right?
You are reaching on this one, Eric. I'm sorry. Maybe next week's show. I'm just struck still by comments such as I mentioned earlier at the top of the show by Senator Alan Simpson with insensitive comments like gun control is how steady you hold your rifle. We had a conversation here with your guest, Mr. Pricer, who pays people who shoot criminals after criminals die. I think these comments and these kind of activities and these statements prove that we need some form of strict gun control in this country and get rid of the 200 million guns on the streets. And maybe that's a better way to protect our citizens and to save lives.
Well, Michael, I don't think that gun control, that anybody thinks it's going to get rid of the 200 million guns on the streets. I think it's going to keep them in the hands of people who commit crimes. You're going to find law-abiding people doing what they always do, complying with the law and registering. At any rate, here again we differ. Now we're really out of time. And we want to thank you, the audience, for watching Flashpoint. Join us again next week when we debate the virtue of so-called multicultural education. In the meantime, for conservative values, I'm Eric Brandel.
And for progressive thinking, I'm Michael Kottman. See you next week. Good night.